bid to ban the local Communist Party and its armed wing, as terror groups, has been blocked by a Manila court. For his take on this, we are now joined by Bayan Muna chairperson and human rights lawyer Nery Colmenares. Attorney Nery, good morning. Welcome back to the program.
Good morning, Mike, at good morning po sa mga listeners ninyo at viewers po ninyo.
First off, Attorney Nery, your reaction to the ruling of Manila RTC Branch 19 on the prescription case filed by the DOJ against the CPP-NPA. It was a very comprehensive resolution which delved into the history, even the inner workings of the CPP-NPA. Your thoughts?
Yes, well, actually, 135 pages ang decision. And I just scanned it this morning because last night, I only got this last night, no? We are not privy to the, we're not lawyers there because actually that case is ex parte. No? Ex parte means to say only one side was heard kasi wala namang lawyers or representatives ang CPP-NPA doon. No? Mm-hmm. And so the judge based her, I think Judge Marlo, I think is she, no?
Yes.
So the judge based her decision on the evidence presented by the government itself and the witnesses presented by government. So yeah, it was very, very, a lot of human rights lawyers and IHL, International Humanitarian Law lawyers, have always contested the terrorism call. Kasi under international humanitarian law, a rebellion is a rebellion. It doesn't necessarily equate with terrorism. That's the law. That's the Geneva Conventions, right? But it was well researched. The judge was she researched a lot of cases, even international authors, and even, of course, a lot of documents. So it was the government itself that provided the evidence from which the judge based her decision. So wala silang kalaban, wala in the sense na nobody represented the other parties. Mm-hmm. It started as 600 ang ni-name nila na respondents. But in the end, I think it was only limited to about 6 or 7 in the end. Kasi the drop yung 590-something-something.
Go ahead, Attorney Nery.
It only shows, and the judge noticed it, na parang they're just, you know, putting in names na CPP-NPA, that's why the judge devoted a large portion, in fact, later on in her decision on the dangers of red tagging. We can discuss that later. Mm-hmm. So generally, that was the decision of the judge. It's a surprising, pleasant surprise for many human rights lawyers kasi a lot of human rights lawyers have been pushing for the peace process. Mm-hmm. And as long as you continue to call your opponent or enemy as terrorist, then peace process will have difficulties in prospering. So I guess the judge is something that the decision is something that the Supreme Court will take notice of. And secondly, it shows that in a judicial, the judge discussed that here in the Human Security Act, it's a full-blown trial where evidence are presented. Whereas yung anti-terror council, the administrative designation lang yon. Walang evidence. No evidence is presented. The designation was decided by a general who is biased. So I guess in a way, I interpret it as the judge saying, why don't you file your prescription cases in court? Why do you have to resort to administrative designation? Because you designate, you didn't consider the evidences. And a lot of people, like the 600 they initially mentioned, the due process rights of a lot of people would have been violated merely because they're activists, they're dissenters, they're opposition, and then you call them CPP-NPA, which is a very dangerous thing. So more or less, that's the gist of the decision as far as I understand it.
No, we will get to the other aspects of the ruling in a bit, but just to set the record, according to the court, actually, the court clarified that only the CPP and the NPA are the respondents here. The 600 plus names initially named were supposedly only for the purpose of serving the summons, eventually trimmed down to two, one of which was CPP founder Jose Maria Sison. But did you anticipate that there would be a categorical ruling in this particular case that the 9 incidents attributed to the CPP-NPA would only be classified as rebellion, not terrorism?
Yes, well, we don't know how judges will rule, but of course, in this case, we were of course, surprised. I was surprised. because I didn't expect that. Ex parte, Mike, meaning to say only the government presented their evidence. The CPP and PA did not even present their evidence. So the court looked at the looked at the documents presented by government, and it showed the documents of the CPP and PA. One, you see, let's go back to the definition muna. The definition under the Human Security Act of terrorism is this. There is a group. One, it is organized for the purpose of committing or engaging in terrorism. Second, or even if it's not organized to engage in terrorism, it commits terrorist acts like arson, murder, for the purpose of spreading widespread and extraordinary fear and panic on the population. And the main intent is to coerce or to force the government to an unlawful demand. So when the government presented the documents of the CPP and PA, the judge saw that, the CPP and PA said, we're going to overthrow the government, we're going to launch armed struggle. And what is the purpose? The purpose is so that there will be social justice, there will be land reform, higher wages, all these social ills. So the judge said, according to your own documents, government, the CPP and PA was for rebellion, but they're not for the purpose of sowing widespread fear. In fact, they were making statements that for the Filipino people against those who invade our country, US, China, etc. So that's the first thing. So now the second thing is, did they commit terrorist acts to sow widespread fear and panic on the population? You see, there is a law under international law which governs conflicts between governments and non-state actors. And that's the Geneva Conventions, Protocol 1, Protocol 2. Now, the judge said, well, ang difficulty kasi ng argumento ng gobyerno is this. Pag nag-armas ka laban sa gobyerno, terorista ka, mahirap na overstretch. Bakit? Kasi kung lahat ng naglalaban sa gobyerno ay terorista, di lahat na lang ng gera, ipiterorista mo na. Yung ginawa ng Katipunan laban sa Spanish government, terrorism yon. Yung ginawa ng mga guerrillas laban sa Philippine government nung panahon ng Hapon, terorismo rin yon. And Hook Balahap, terorismo din yon. Nelson Mandela of ANC, of the African National Congress, was once called terrorist kasi nag-armas ang ANC laban sa mga puti na nagro-rule at nag-o-oppress sa South Africa. So, hindi pwede. Kung ngayon, kung ang purpose ng isang grupo sa under international law, under Geneva Conventions, is to overthrow the government, armed struggle, at ang purpose niya ay itong gobyernong ito ay dictator, si Idi Amin ng Uganda, etc. Then it's regulated by hindi siya terrorism. It's, of course, pwede kang mag-violate ng rules, halimbawa, under a Geneva Conventions. Sige, maglaban kayo dyan, in-invade mo ang isang bansa. Ngayon, pag in-invade mo yung isang bansa, pag nag-torture ka ng kalaban mo, pag pumatay ka ng protected persons like civilians, na yun ang purpose, mapatayin talaga ang civilian, then you violate IHL. May penalty, yes, may penalty. But it's not terrorism. Kasi kung terrorism yan, o di lahat na lang ng gera, terorismo. Ang pag-invade ng Amerika sa laban sa gobyerno ng Iraq, o di nag-armas ka, lumabang ka, pinatay mo yung sundalo ng mga Iraqis, o di terorista ka na rin. But no, it's regulated under Geneva Conventions. At sabi ng korte, in fact, it took pains na i-explain, sinabi ng Supreme Court sa Medjeldea versus, Lagman versus Medjeldea, na ang rebellion yon directed against the government. Pag ang gawa mo ay directed purposely against civilians, edi yun ang terorismo. Parang may ganong dinis-discuss ang court somewhere sa decision. So yun ang differentiation niya. Kaya ang pagpatay daw sa Siam, kasi dinismiss niya na yung iba. Sabi niya, yung pag-ambush sa military, part yun ng gera. Mahaba na yung Supreme Court decisions dyan Hernandez ruling pa yan. Part yun ng gera. Pag pinatay ng sundalo ang NPA at pinatay ng NPA ang sundalo, gera yun. Hindi yung terorismo. Nangyayari yan sa buong mundo. Pangalawa, pagpatay mo ng mga spies, yung suspected spy, ano yan, membro mo, tingin mo spy, o di, hindi yan terorismo. Ang terorismo kasi directed against civilians talaga purposely. Ngayon, sabi niya, may mga namatay na civilian, dito tayo mag-focus. May sinabi ang mga witnesses na mga pinatay na civilian. So ang pinoint out ng judge una, tinanong niyang witnesses, paano yun nalang ang NPA? Kasi naka-uniform ng black. Mm-hmm. Sabi ng judge, yun bang official uniform ng NPA? Hindi naman, hindi ma-officially established kung anong uniforme ng NPA. Secondly, sabi ng judge, Mindanao nangyari yung Siam. Alam mo naman sa Mindanao, ang dami-daming armed groups doon. Hindi mo. The third is, of course, kung babalik tayo doon sa basic principle ng IHL, tingin nila military spies, tingin nila military. So part yan ng gyera nila sa gobyerno. Hindi yun intended against civilians. Tapos, anong extraordinary fear and panic ang kinos noon? Nagkaroon ba ng panic sa buong, unlike ni 9/11, di ba, nung binomba ang yung Twin Towers sa New York, talagang nagulantang ang buong bansa. Dito sabi niya, hindi nga alam, marami yan . So hindi na fulfill ang mga elements ng terrorist definition. And lastly, sabi ng judge, ano ang unlawful demand nila? Ang demand kasi nila, sabi niya, reform, dagdag sahod sa manggagawa, yung mga rights, protect our patrimony, di ba? Ganun ang nakalagay sa mga dokumentong sinabit ng gobyerno. So, nag-demand ba ang NPA-CPP? Pinatay nila ang Siam, tapos may demand ba silang pinalabas sa gobyerno na, demand namin ganito? Wala . Sabi niya. Pangalawa, kahit kapag nga nag-demand sila, yung demand naman nila, yung mga land reform, yung mga ganun, di ba? So, sabi niya, hindi naman unlawful yun. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Kaya ang ending ng judge, kaya nga siguro dapat, ang sabi niya, dapat i-address ng gobyerno ang peace process, ang roots of the conflict. Alam mo, Mike, ang mga tao, isang tao, hindi naman siya pupunta sa bundok just because trip niya lang . Trip ko pumunta sa labanan ng gobyerno. May nagtulak doon. Kasi ang hirap ng buhay sa bundok. Pwede kang mamatay, pwede kang, hindi mo makita pamilya mo, wala ka na. Lahat na yun, lahat ng kahirapan. For nothing? Of course, injustice yon, poverty yon, kahirapan yon. Yun ang nagtulak. Government, i-address nyo kaya yun, sabi ng judge. Kasi the moment na ma-address nyo yung roots of the conflict, yung kahirapan, lahat, kahit ano pa yung recruitment ng CBP-NPA, walang papasok na dyan kasi maganda na yung buhay ng tao . Pero as long as insensitive kayo, at quoting of course Chief Justice Fernando, in the case of Lansang, I think, the Supreme Court, na kung saan sabi ni Justice Fernando, hindi naman pwedeng i-violate mo yung Constitution just because sabihin mo may danger, di ba? Sa iyo may rebellion. So, ang trato ng mundo kasi sa rebellion is political crime. Mm-hmm. Ang sabi niya nga, one man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter. Para sa si Nelson Mandela ng South Africa, terorista pa. Gobyerno siyempre, mga puti, ayaw nila ng ANC. Pero Attorney para sa South Africano, freedom fighter si Mandela.
Attorney Neri, the ruling was based on the Human Security Act, no? Definition of terrorism, which as you mentioned, there are certain elements which is different from the definition of terrorism under the Anti-Terrorism Act. How do you think this will play out? Because do you think that the ruling of the judge, if applied under the Anti-Terrorism Act, will that still hold?
Well, the problem there explained by the judge at length doon sa kanyang first part ng decision. Una, sabi niya, final ito under HSA, under 2007 na terrorism law. By the way, draconian ang Human Security Act. Ha? Grabe rin yun, matindi rin yun. Doon final ng gobyerno. Ngayon, sabi niya, nang nakapending na to, may bagong batas, yung ATA nga ng 2020. Kaya lang, sabi niya, nakalagay doon sa ATA mismo ang saving clause. All cases pending bago naging effective itong bagong batas, effective yon. Continue. Kasi sabi niya, may jurisdiction ako. Otherwise, may saving clause. Pangalawa, ex post facto. Kasi lumala ang penalties dito sa ATA, kundi parang you're punishing a person for something na higher ang penalty later. Yung wala naman yung batas na yun at the time na kinasuhan mo siya. Binago mo yung evidentiary rules, sabi niya. Kasi iba na yung evidentiary rules sa ano, itataka nga ako bakit inapprove ng Korte Suprema yan sa ATA, di ba? So sabi niya, hindi naman, ang basic rule naman natin, kung ano yung batas ng panahong final mo ang kaso, ang panahong ginawa ang mga acts na yon, yun yung kaso mo. Kung ginawa nyo ng 2017, 2014, 2015, hindi mo pwedeng gamitin yung 2020 na batas para doon sa action na ginawa niya nung years before the law was passed.
But in terms of the implications of this ruling, Attorney Neri, of course, the element of sowing extraordinary fear and panic to coerce the government to give in to unlawful demand, those seem to be missing under the Anti-Terrorism Act now. So can anyone, for example, accused or being prescribed under the Anti-Terrorism Act still use these defenses that were raised by the court to justify that, no, you cannot consider them terrorism because that act of terrorism does not actually, or that particular act did not actually so extraordinary fear, panic, and for the stated purpose under this particular ruling?
I'm sure the lawyers of anyone accused under the ATA will use that argument, using the court as precedent. And it's up for the Supreme Court. Will we be better judges for the people or justices for the people, or will just side with the administration here? So they can, of course, use it. But that's the problem of the anti-terror law. It's so vague. It's so, you know, di ba, overbroad. Alam nyo na yan. Anybody can be charged with anything kasi it's undefined na bigla. While the Human Security Act said, if you commit arson, murder, chemical weapons, lahat ng mga acts, kidnapping, gano'n, nakalagay. And the purpose is to sow fear and panic to the population, widespread, extraordinary, then pwedeng pumasok sa terrorism. Dito sa ATA kasi, anyone who intends to interfere with critical infrastructure, huh? Kahit sinong abogado tanongin mo, anong definition? Kahit sinong justice ng Korte Suprema tanongin natin? Anong ibig sabihin nun? Seriously interfere with the critical infrastructure. Terorista ka? Ano yung critical infrastructure? Traffic, highway is a nagrally-rally ka doon na block mo ang traffic ng isang araw, o do you interfere na with the critical infrastructure? O di yung EDSA people power pala, terrorist action, kasi binlock mo yung EDSA for 4 days eh. You interfere with the critical infrastructure. At the act of the People Power Act in 1986, which was hailed by the world as an act of courage against a dictator, is now considered a terrorist act under the ATA. Kaya malaking gulat namin na inapprove ng Korte Suprema, but that's something, it's another story. But it was very clear in the case of Southern Hemisphere doon sa Human Security Act na sinabi ng ano, na penal law itong Human Security Act, therefore mag-apply dito yung ating rules on criminal laws, which
is... And finally, very quickly, I'm sorry, we don't have much time though.
Okay lang.
I just want to get the implications of this ruling. Will this stop red tagging now that you have a court saying, warning against the dangers of red tagging? Will this actually mean the NTFLCAC will stop red tagging or linking or terrorist labeling, considering that the NTFLCAC yesterday is still insisting it has basis to classify CPP-NPA as terrorist groups?
Una muna, as a lawyer, I'm very concerned na si Judge Marlo will be red tagged now. Ganyan talagang danger noon. The second is, government witnesses mismo ang nagsabi. Nasabi nila, nagkakaroon kami ng mga organisasyon like open organization like LFS or Bayan Muna. Nag-encourage kami ng member doon. Ang tanong ng judge sa mga witnesses, ang mga members ba dyan ay CPP-NP? Hindi pa, sabi nila. Ngayon doon, yung tingin namin medyo abante, i-recruit namin sa, ang term nila, NDUGMO.
National Democratic...
Not even.
Underground mass organization.
Parang kabataang makabayan, halimbawa. O di, ganun. Member na ba ng CPP-NP? Hindi pa. Tapos ang abante naman daw doon, tsaka nila i-recruit sa CPP-NPA. So sabi ng judge sa decision niya, hindi Marami palang miyembro ng bayan mo na LPS, itong mga sinasabi nyo, hindi nga nila alam na CPP NPA, tapos pag nirentag mo, lahat sila irentag mo. So, bakit naman nila lump sum? Yun ang danger dyan, sabi niya. Kasi ilalump sum mo siya, kayo mismo gobyerno umamin na hindi naman lahat ng miyembro dyan CPP NPA, bakit nyo nilalump sum? So that was the thing. So will it stop the NTF-LCAP? Well, I hope it will stop the entire government. Kasi alam mo, kaya lumalala at kaya natatalo sila, nag-overreach sila eh. Pwede namang itukoy mo yung isang tingin mo CPP-NPA o di kasuhan mo sa korte. Hindi yung ang artista ay CPP-NPA, yung pare ay CPP-NPA, yung Ateneo, yung Lasal. Lahat sila, bayan muna, lahat ng activist at dissenter, pati si Lenny Robredo, CPP-NPA, doon sila natatalo. O di may problemang malaki. So I really hope na ihinto na ang red tagging at kung tingin nila ay CPP-NPA, o di kasuhan nila ng rebellion ang mga CPP-NPA members.
All right, on that note, unfortunately we don't have much time. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Atty. Nery Colmenares.
Maraming salamat din po. Thank you.